Dolores, I remember recording. Okay, so let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much. We thank you for Thursdays. We thank you for all the days of the week because we can get up in the morning and say, this is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And we can be excited about the fact that we are your children and you are our Father. Now bless this lesson. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we're starting with, and somebody is not muted.
Whoops.
Can everybody mute themselves? Okay, Grace, that was you. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Okay. I hope you can see this, those that are on your computers. We are talking about mothers of the Bible. Mothers of the Bible. And let me make sure that I'm recorded here. Mothers of the Bible. And in this, we are going to be doing today, mothers in Genesis. And I'm not going to start off with Eve. I'm not going to start off with her because we always start with Eve. You know Eve. You know who Eve is. You know what Eve is all about. All of us have learned that that was the first woman to come out of Adam because God put Adam to sleep and brought her out. But we are going to be talking about these mothers here. And the first mother named woman that is mentioned after Eve, her name was Sarai. Sarai. And that name meant princess or lady of stature and class. And she was the wife of Abraham. If you ever went to a Sunday school class or if you ever went to a class about, summer Bible school. You had a song that said, Father Abraham had many sons, and many sons of Father Abraham, I am one of them, and so are you. So let's all praise the Lord. Well, I'm saying that Father Abraham couldn't have had any sons if it wasn't for the daughters, if it wasn't for the women. And Abraham's nowadays kids say, his story is a ratchet story. That means he was a guy that had no business doing what he did. First of all, he came out of Ur of the Chaldees, which is in the west, back over there, in the east, back over there where Iraq and Iran was. He was an idol worshiper, but he had some things that said to him, somebody came in unmuted. Okay, I got him. Thank you. He came in to excuse me, I gotta try to mute these people. Hold on.
Here we go. First up, that is a 14-piece pack of sugar-free gum.
Because I've got a lot going on. Excuse me. Right there. Okay. Found them. I'm sorry. If you come in, please, if anybody comes in, they need to be muted. Okay, so Father Abraham, he came from the era of the Chaldees, which was over in the east, the same place that the three kings came, or they say the three kings, but the kings came to worship Jesus. Now, in this case, Abraham was and is the son of a very wealthy man over there. So Abraham had money. Abraham was rich. He had cattle. He had people. He had lives, almost like a Job of the East. And one day he decided there got to be something out here different from what this is, because we're worshiping these statues and the statues are just standing. They don't talk. They don't speak. I know that my wealth and everything else had to come from something greater than myself, greater than myself. So I need to find out where this came from and who these people are and where who is this? And because he seeked for God, God revealed himself to him. And when he revealed himself to him, he said to him, he says, Abraham, I am God, and I want you to leave all of your kinfolk, and I want you to come out from among them and go to a place that I want to show you. So Abraham does. He goes to a place. He starts out. He had told his wife Sarai, he said, and his name was Abram at the time. He told his wife Sarai, he said, Sarai, I've heard from God. And she's going, God? Well, who is God? You know, all everything we ever knew was this was God. He says, God has to be something greater than ourselves. So the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that's who God is. And so now he leaves and he's on his way to find God. But God has already chosen him to be the father of many nations and to bless him. At that time, Sarai was about 75 years old. She was very old, and she was very beautiful. Very beautiful. This is all in the book of Genesis. Her name is the only female that's named after Eve. Right after Eve, the next woman that you meet is Sarai or Sarah. And now she and Abraham and all of his people and all of his servants, all of his cattle and everything start moving to the west where God is showing them to go. And that is into what was called the land of Canaan at that time. And as he moved, God started revealing himself. There's something that is said about that. A lot of times we want God to tell us where we're going before he shows us. We want to know. We want to know, well, what are you putting me through? Where I got to go? What I got to do? Who I got to talk to? God will not start working with you until you start moving and doing the first thing that he tells you. He is not going to keep revealing stuff to you until he knows that you have the faith to trust him and to move out. So Sarah moves out, but Abraham makes a big mistake. Abraham takes his nephew Lot with him. Why would he take Lot? Because Lot's father died. And he didn't want to leave him with the grandfather. And because he and Sarai had no children, he says, okay, we're not only going to take, all our herdsmen and all of our people, but we're going to take Lot and his herdsmen and his people as well. So he brought trouble with him because he didn't do what God told him to do. Sometimes we do a little bit of what God tells us to do, and then we do something that, yeah, he told me to do this, but I'm going to add something to it. And the part that you add to it, if it's not of God, it's not going to work. And you're going to eventually have to go back and do the first thing that God told you to do. So now they move out, and they get to Sarai is very beautiful. But she's barren. She has no children. She's taking Lot to be her child. A lot of us haven't had any children, but we have God children and adopted children. So we are still mothers, even if we did not produce a child from our bodies. Some are foster parents, never had any children of their own, but have love and they want to take care and nourish children. So in that respect, all of us are mothers, whether by natural birth or by design or by adopting or fostering or just taking children of friends or aunties or cousins, and they look at you as their second mother or their mother if their mother has passed. So this is what Sarah and Abraham, Sarai and Sarah, I'm going to say Sarah from now on, and Abraham thought about Lot. He's like a son to us, so we're going to take him with us. But he wasn't a son, and God did not consider him a son. And so therefore, they were not in the will of God. So now, beautiful but barren, she's 75 years old and still beautiful. How beautiful was Sarai? Sarah, she was so beautiful that when they were going, they ran into a famine which means no food, no water, no anything. But they ended up in Egypt. And as they were coming, the Egyptian guards and the people that watched the land as people approached Egypt saw this multitude of people. But one of them, one of the guards, focused on Sarah at 75 years old. She was so beautiful that now he goes and he tells Pharaoh, there are a group of people coming across the desert. And in that group, there is a woman that is so beautiful, I think she should belong to you. And belong to you. First of all, you don't know her circumstance or anything else, but you are now fixing up the Pharaoh who has a multitude. He has a harem, he has a lot of women, but this guard or whoever it was went and said, there's one. So Pharaoh says, invite them. Now, Abraham gets this inkling that because of Sarah's beauty, she's going to be taken from him. So when they send for him, he says to her, listen, don't tell them that you're my wife because they might kill me. Tell them that you're my sister. Now, is it true? Yes, because they had different mothers, but the same father. So that made them sisters and brothers, but we call them half or whatever. So his wife was actually his sister or half sister or whatever. It was in the family. Okay, so now they take Sarah in, and they groom her, they give her servants. Oh, they make her so beautiful. And the night that Pharaoh is getting ready to sleep with her, a message comes from God to him. And he don't believe in this God, but this message says, don't touch her. That's not his sister, that is his wife. So Abraham now goes in, he's called in, he says, why did you lie to me? Why did you tell me this was your sister when it's really your wife? So he's trying to explain all the technicalities of it. But really, the Pharaoh was so angry, he says, everybody that has served her, anything that she has touched, anything, get it out of here. I don't want to have anything to do with her, her things, or anything else. Coming with her was a beautiful young lady named Hagar. Young, but she was a servant in Pharaoh's house. So when they kicked all of them off the land and gave them everything and told them to go because they were going to bring bad vibes onto Egypt, Hagar left and came. Hagar was the first unwed mother. Who was her baby daddy? Let's go to Maury on this one. Who was a baby daddy? It was Abraham. And he was about 85 years old, close to 90 years old. Sarai, he came and told Sarai that God says that I am going to be the father of many nations. And she says, well, how are you going to be the father of many nations if we don't even have any children? And I'm too old to have children. But you know what? We brought this chick out of Egypt, this young, beautiful woman. And Abraham, I want you to sleep with her and make children in my name with this young woman. Well, Abraham should have said, no, Sarah, we're going to trust God on this one. I don't know how he's going to do it. But he looked at this girl, hips and everything else, and the beauty and the darkness of her skin. And he said, okay, pitch a tent. Let me get busy. And he did. He went in, he slept with her. She got pregnant. Now, it was no choice of her. She couldn't say no. So it was actually a rape, if you want to say so. Or if you think about women that live in houses where they entertain men, you have a woman that they call a madam who sets these women up with the men. This stuff didn't happen just now. It's been happening since the beginning of time. That's why we're doing this study about mothers of the Bible, because women were molested, they were given away, they were sold, they were exchanged. Women in the Bible, and you're going to get some of those stories. So if you know anybody else that would like to come along with this, please invite them on Thursdays at 11. So now he goes into her. She gets pregnant, and now she is walking around, And you know, when you get pregnant, eventually you're going to get big, looking like a watermelon underneath and everything. Sarah now gets jealous of the mess she made. And she's so mean to her. As the girl gets more beautiful and more voluptuous with the baby in her, she is so mean. Sarah now is almost 90 years old herself, not yet, 75, 80, around in there. And she is just mean and getting meaner and meaner. So Hagar says, I don't have to take this. And she runs off and she goes into the desert. In the meantime, remember we talked about angels. An angel of the Lord came and told her, that is Abraham's child and you have got to go back. I don't care how mean she is to you. You have got to go back for the sake of Abraham, because that is his seed and God has made a promise to Abraham about his seeds. So you are just a pawn in this game. Go back. So she went back and Sarah continued to harass her, but she had the baby and she named him Ishmael. Ishmael was the first child of Abraham. Guess who else Ishmael is? He is the father of the Islamic faith. So Hagar becomes the mother of the Islamic faith. We call them Muslims, Islam. She is the mother of that faith out of Abraham, this child. So now she's the first unwed mother. She's living in a condition that she can't stand. And the child is growing up. And all of a sudden, the beautiful Sarah, God comes and says to Abraham, remember that promise I made you? I'm still going to be good on that promise, even though you guys decided to help me out the wrong way. Sarah will have a child. When Sarah heard this, she wasn't with the men when they announced it. She laughed. And God said to her, why are you laughing? She said, I didn't laugh, my Lord. You did laugh. And so therefore, this time next year, as it fits a woman in labor, you will have a child. Sarah was 90 years old. Can you imagine being 90? Can you imagine being the age you are right now, having a child? No, you can't. But she did. And then Abraham said, but look at me. He said, is anything too hard for God? She had a child. The child was named Isaac. In the meantime, Hagar's child was growing up with Isaac. Finally, Sarah said, I will not have this bond woman and her child grow up with my child. So she told Abraham, get rid of them, put them out. And so now here's this unwed mother, child is about 13 years old. He gives her a pitcher of water and a loaf of bread and sends her out into the desert to fend for himself. But God knew what was going on and he took care of them. She had more belief after that pregnancy and raising that child in what was the believer's place. She said to God, because she took the baby and she put him out. He was the young man. She just, when they ran out of water and everything, she just moved him away from her. And she just cried out to the Lord, what did I do to deserve this? And he came down and she found water. The spring came. God answered. And then finally she said to God, El Roi. That's what she called him, El Roi, the God that sees and hears me. All we want to know when we go through our go-throughs, is there a God that sees and hears what I'm going through? And I'm going to say to you, yes, you've got better than that since the cross. You have a God that lives inside of you. Not only that sees and hears, but feels everything you feel and knows everything you know. And if you trust and believe, he will bring you through on the other side better than you did when you went through your crises. Okay, so Hagar is now gone. Ishmael is now gone. the Abraham and Sarah's baby's name is Isaac, and Isaac means son of laughter. Why? Because she laughed when she heard that she was going to have a child at 90 years old. Abraham is 100. And so Isaac and Abraham and Sarah without Hagar are doing well. Hagar goes on, and Ishmael, he has 12 children, just like the grandsons of Abraham. There will be 12 of them. She has the wealthiest. If you look at the Arab nation today, they are the wealthiest nation, but guess who they are? They are Hagar's children, and they are from Abraham out of Ishmael. Well, Sarah passes away, and she was 100 and some odd years when she passed away. Abraham said, let me get my son a wife now. His mother is gone. Maybe a woman will comfort him. So they send for Rebecca. And they seem to think that when Rebecca came back, she came back with her maid, Keturah. Many people don't know anything about Keturah. But at 140 some years old, Abraham gets married again to Keturah, a young woman. That is his second wife, and she has 6 children for him. 6. So now everybody knows about Abraham, Isaac, and Ishmael. They know about those men. But she has 6 men children for Abraham. He dies at 175 years old after having 6 more sons. Now we have a dysfunctional family all the way because he has 8 children by 3 different women. But who is the child of promise? The child that God promised Abraham came through Sarah in the miracle of her having a child at 90 years old and nursing that child at 90 years old and staying long enough to see him grow up. So you can see that we have 3 cases in this one story about Abraham's wives. We have the wife that he came to God with. We have the wife, the concubine, they called them back then, or the servant of Sarah. We have her, Hagar, who came out of Egypt out of a lie. And then we have Keturah, who came when they were trying to find a wife for Rebecca, for Isaac, who was going to be Rebecca. And these Keturah, now Abraham is married to, Isaac is now married. And where is Sarah? Sarah has died and gone on. In this little time that we've had together, you see that women had no calling for their lives. Whatever the men chose to do with them, that's what was allowed. So how important is the cross for women? When Jesus died upon that cross, we were given equal footing with men. There is no more male or female in the kingdom, because when we get there, we will all be there not to have any more children, but to praise and to worship our God forever and ever. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this study. We thank you, Lord, for what we're doing about women. And this is the time that we should be doing it, because in crises, women and their children are the most vulnerable. Those are the people that have the most to lose. Men, yes, they work or whatever, but something that you have carried for 9 months, something that stays on your heart, the child that even once they're grown, you still think about them, or you think about your own mother and what she had to go through to make sure that you got where you are. We think about grandmothers. We think about all of these people, Lord, these women, whether of God or not, that you said, I will care for you. When mother and father forsake you, I will take you up. So all of us, knowing that we have mothers, we have had mothers, we have been and stood in for mothers, We need this study, Lord. Show us from your word how much things have not changed from back then till now, and show us how to be the women of God that you want us to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.